Good morning to everybody. First of all, our UGS College principal will welcome all the participants and chief guests. Then our CEO, Dr. M. Chinnathurai, will intro our chief guest of this webinar. Then webinar presentation. At the end of the webinar presentation, what are that? Then let us leave the room. But I request our principal to give the welcome address.
Namaskaram and good morning to all. I welcome our proud alumni, Mr. C. Sundar Narayanan. It's happy and blessings to have an excellent webinar. this webinar is about manufacturing engineering as a service offering. It is conducted by our mechanical engineering department. This webinar is will be hosted by external the expert persons, Mr. C. Sundar Narayanan. So I welcome all the participants to have a great interaction with our expert person, to have a great session, have a good webinar. Use this opportunity for your for enriching your betterment. So thank you very much. I welcome our COE, Mr. Chinnathurai sir, to welcome the to introduce our chief guest. Sir, please.
Yes, sir. Welcome and greetings from EGSPL Engineering College. It's the autonomous institution from 2017 onwards. Then again, I welcome our the today's chief guest, Professor. Actually, then not a professor. He's one of my classmates. Then he's a well-known person also than anybody. He's a very very good industry expert. On behalf of alumni of our institution, I welcome our alumni for this wonderful webinar. This time I'm very happy to introduce my friend as well as the today's chief guest for this webinar. His experience around 17 plus experience in manufacturing engineering and engineering service business. Closely work with the client across North America, Mexico, Japan and part of Europe. Integral part of the leadership that developed a team from 10 to 130 in a span of 5 years, which consistently catered to the OEMs around the globe to launch their NPIs in a shorter span and to optimize their operating expenditure on the current product lines using digital tools and world-class manufacturing techniques. Worked in production engineering center with a Japanese Tier 1 automotive manufacturer with the 80 plus global locations worldwide to digitally simulate and validate their manufacturing plans for introducing new lines, introducing new product in existing line, improving the current product line, production line. They handle a team of engineers at a leading construction machinery manufacturer to develop, modify electrical harness design of hydraulic excavator for a global OEM's Japanese market. Also worked on customizing the harness design for local market in India. Worked with one of the leading agri equipment manufacturers in USA for the launch of their next generation axle combine harvester. Anyway, thank you for introducing my friend. Thank you all. Thank you, sir.
I request our webinar presenter, Mr. Sundar Narayanan, to present his webinar.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Kashyap. Good morning, everyone. I'll share my screen now and see if it's working properly. Then we'll get into the presentation. Are you all able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. You can proceed.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. good morning, everyone. Chinnathurai has already given a quick introduction about myself. I'll just once again reiterate a little bit on my expertise areas, what I was doing all this year after my passing out of college. I am a alumni of 1998-2002 batch mechanical engineering from our college. And I have about 17 plus years of experience in new product design and manufacturing engineering arena. That's the core area what I have been working till now from the start of my career. Initial few years are from the new product development side, which I was in teams that were developing new designs for global and local automotive off-highway vehicle customers. Then over a period of time, I moved from new product development area into manufacturing engineering area, where the new product development team is one of my input. I receive input from them and we set up the factories that the product has been developed for. That was the core area after first few years of my life. The second half was in the manufacturing engineering. And industry wise, since I was in engineering service business, I've been introduced across the industrial verticals like automotive, off-highway vehicles, tractors and other off-highway road vehicles, then agriculture equipment, construction equipments, ranging from small electronics to biggest truck. I have seen the manufacturing facilities of all the products. And exposure wise across the geography also, I have worked with countries like US, Europe, across Europe, and mainly with Japan also, to some extent in Romania and France and Mexico. So industrial setup wise, I'll be able to understand how each country performs, what is the level of factories in each country, where are we going towards in the next few years, what is the target for those countries to go into the manufacturing, to what extent they want to go. I have the idea on that. And as a part of a core team in a production engineering center with a Japanese tier one manufacturer, I've hands-on experimented some digital tools also in the manufacturing engineering services. What kind of digital tools are we using right now in the industry, the leading players in the industry, what are they doing to optimize their factory? That knowledge I have gained from a Japanese tier one manufacturer. And this today's presentation is mainly focused on the learnings that I have acquired from those projects, digital projects only. That's where we are, because since it is a one and a half hour session, we will be focusing on a specific target, and I wanted to talk on digital validation and simulation kind of opportunities in the global market. So agenda wise, what we would want to do is today, we'll see an overview on the ER&D business. What is ER&D industry and what is that business, how big it is. And then in the ER&D, one portion is a product development lifecycle. So starting from your idea generation until it reaches the customer, how, in what cycle a product is getting developed. And in the product level development cycle, what is manufacturing engineering, role of manufacturing engineering. And in the manufacturing engineering, what is the role of digital validations. So specific, our today's session will be focused specifically on digital validation aspects only. And from digital validation, as a next step, the whole world is moving towards Industry 4.0. We'll see a one quick slider on what is smart manufacturing, what are the industries doing in the future. So today's area is core, will be focused on this digital validation perspective. ER&D business. When you see the word ER&D, it's engineering research and development industry mainly. So what does this ER&D specify is any organization that has a design capability, or any organization, global organization, that puts up a design center in another country like India, Mexico or Japan, or their whole design center will be put up in one country. Our engineering service providers who don't own any product, but who will be catering to the research and development of the product manufacturing and all the aspects only on the services side. They don't own the product. They work for the OEMs as a service provider, but they will also be in the core business of your product design to manufacturing. And the defense and public sector units that concentrate on research and development. And to some extent, the academics who are supporting all these organizations in research and development area. This is the whole ER&D industry as such in the world. And at this juncture, close 2020, we are around $1.4 trillion US dollar volume of business we are generating. That's the size of business this industry talks about in general, as a whole, in the world, what I'm telling you. And India, approximately 30% of this business right now comes to India. Being a IT service provider for many of the countries, we have strong capability in IT support area, not in the innovation aspects. IT support side, we do a lot of business, and this industry is IT enabled service. This is a subset of this Indian IT industry. And the ITES spend, what we are out of this $1.4 trillion ER&D, close to 40 to 45 billion is the volume what India is catering to at this point of time. So that's the size of business that the world is dealing with, India and world is dealing with right now in the industry. So engineering services maturity, if we see in the 90s, when this digital transformation started, when we started investing in computers, when India started opening up to foreign businesses, when we became more outward looking policy country than inward looking, we brought in a lot of computers inside, and as a result of that, we started getting projects in IT and this kind of industries. So in 90s, if we see, mostly the project that we would get is in the form of piecemeal, one of a kind project. The client will contact the company and give a project. It's a small one-time work, and an engineer will be allotted. We will execute it and send it back. So it's a contract engineer, like one engineer or two engineers will work at the maximum. Most of the projects will be legacy conversion, in which you get a scanned PDF file of a drawing. You convert it into an AutoCAD drawing. At that time, AutoCAD was prevalent than any other software. So it was a 2D area. You receive a scanned, rough, old drawing, scanned version. There will be a lot of dimensions in there. You need to interpret that and make it into a digital AutoCAD drawing and send it back to the customer. A little portion, some portion of it was the ROE kind of work, 3D work will be there. But majority of work, what we were doing was raster conversion projects, they say, converting from a scanned PDF file to an AutoCAD digital file. And that industry was growing slowly. And in the early 2000s and mid-2000s, what started to happen is the contract engineer teams slowly converted into contract teams. The volume of business increased. Clients started giving a lot of projects, and slowly the companies became bigger. They invested on a lot of softwares, new 3D modeling softwares, and pitched that as a capability to the customers across the globe. So what happened is, naturally, as a natural evolvement, companies became bigger, and we started focusing on software mainly. At that time, if you go into any engineering service company and talk, they will identify themselves as a software-based team. That is, I am working in ProE, I am working in Unigraphics, I am SolidWorks team. That's how people used to identify themselves. And concept designs will come from the customer mostly. Hand sketches or rough 3D models will come from the customer. And we will be doing detailed design of the projects. For that, the whole quotation, we have to submit a quotation that I will invest this many hours and I will get this much amount. And the customer will award the project. We'll do it and hand it back to the customer. That's how the early 2000s and mid-2000s, you see that kind of projects a lot. And on-site deputation started. So when this is happening, somebody was needed at on-site to coordinate team from India. So one of the senior engineer gets deputed to on-site to any country that the project is being offered from. And what he does is he coordinates with the offshore team and get the project done. This is how the on-site deputation kind of thing started in 2000s. And the next decade, when we see in 2010, 10, 15, in this time, since we get deputed to on-site, since the teams get deputed to on-site, the engineer who went on-site had got opportunity to interact with the team there in the US, and he get to attend a lot of the customers' product development meetings. So slowly he started to acquire product knowledge. Till then, we were only modeling and developing kind of people, but slowly we started concentrating on what product my customer is making, and what is this model year's design, and what is the next model year design that we are going to release, and what's the advantage of our product, and if the customer has a competitor in the market, what's the advantage and disadvantage of the competitor's product? So we started getting slowly into the product knowledge category, that knowing more about what we are making. So till that 2000s, that was not at all a point of concern for us. But from 2010s, we started concentrating on the design aspect of the product also. So whatever knowledge the engineer acquires from the onsite, he gave it to offshore teams. He gave a lot of knowledge sharing sessions. And the offshore teams slowly started to identify themselves on a client-based team perspective. So when you talk to somebody on an engineering service company in 2010-15, they will identify themselves on a name of a customer, that I am from Honda team, I am from Toyota team. That kind of name will pop up. So software is not a concern at this point of time. Whatever customer uses, we are going to use. But we mainly concentrated on products at this point of time. And since the product knowledge was more, when the customer, there is a US model developed, when the customer wants to develop a model for a low-cost country, de-feature the product and develop it for a low-cost country, they sent the whole model to our team, and our guys analyzed that model and de-feature some unnecessary items like AC unit. If it is not needed in Mexico, remove the AC and put a fan there instead of AC. That kind of de-featuring started to happen. We started to involve in this kind of projects in 2010s, 15s. And right now in 2020, if you see what the engineering service industry is doing, we are seen as a value-added partner right now. So there are a lot of ODC concepts, offshore design centers, they say. Closed door, teams will be working inside. The reason to keep ODC is, now the team is jointly working with the client teams in many of the aspects. There are a lot of joint patents being filed. Lot of core technologies that the customer is using is there in Indian teams right now. The teams are exposed to a lot of new next year designs and other aspects. And we co-author a lot of patents with the customer also. So slowly, from a contract engineer perspective, in another 20, 30 years time, we are right now in a situation of being seen as a value added partner to the customer. So right now we develop products along with the customer. That's the growth of this industry, maturity level. So having seen that, product development cycle, this is a quick overview only. So starting from the idea generation phase, when we see some vacuum in the market that we can fill, there the idea gets sparked in the mind of somebody. And starting from market research on whether the product will work or not, doing a demographic study and positioning that particular product in the market, which category will buy, who will make it. And then it goes to the concept design stage, where we create a rough concept of how my product will look like, how will the aesthetics be, how will the ergonomics be. All that basic concepts will be developed. Then it comes to the design portion, in which you create a 3D model, detail it out, and check for manufacturability, decide on material, decide on the cost, and then you move to validation perspective, that if it is easy to assemble or if it is easy to make, how it will look like, and if there is any functionality with respect to force application or anything, you do a CAE, FEA or CFD analysis, and then you plan the process on how to make it in the shop floor and prototype it, develop the prototype, prove it out, and send it to the market. This is a whole cycle of a product development, starting from where it occurs in your mind till it reaches the customer. So in this area, in manufacturing engineering, if you see, this is the kind of portion what we would talk about, where the design is getting finalized, and when we start to talk about whether it is manufacturable or not, at what cost we'll be manufacturing it, what kind of material are we going to finalize, how are we going to make it? When this question pops up, manufacturing engineering automatically comes into picture. So this is the whole portion a manufacturing engineering is. So manufacturing engineering, you can build anything once, but if you want to build more than that, you are going to listen to me, a manufacturing engineer. This is a famous saying of a manufacturing engineer, that any product can be made only once. That's not a big deal. Anybody can assemble it once. But if you want to make a second piece of it, and if you want to continuously start making it, you need to listen to a manufacturing engineer, because he's the one who will help you realize the dream of making something continuously on a same design with consistent quality. So his area, his or her area, what you see will be from design validation, DFX. What we say is design for assembly, design for manufacturing, design for cost, all that will come into DFX. So starting from validation, then plan the process, plan the tool, plan the layout, or plan the work cell where the operators will be working, and help in start up the production, prototype building, standardization, optimization, logistics. All these will be under the umbrella of manufacturing engineering. So if a company has a manufacturing engineering department, that team will be taking care of all these expectations from a end user, or expectation from a company point of view or a product point of view. This is what they'll be dealing with. These are the topics they'll be talking day in, day out in their life. Industry challenge wise, if you see, if there is an industry right now, if somebody is starting industry or if there is an industry running, there are two critical challenges right now. At any point of time, not even right now, at any point of time, the industry will be facing these two industry challenges always. One is your NPA timeline. What happens is, any product is planned, there are two companies which are parallelly working, a new concept is developed, so almost designs are similar because they got input from the market and they developed a solution for the market. Two similar designs are getting designed and they want to launch it in the market. The introduction timeline, from the time that idea is parked in mind to the time that it reaches the customer, the timeline plays a very critical role. If you are first to the market, if you launch it quickly to the market, you gain a good market share. So any company would want to be the pioneer into the market when there is any new design idea that comes into mind. To make that happen, you need to be strong in doing your design for manufacturing analysis, and any error that pops up during design stage should not come into the manufacturing area. So you need to avoid that as much as possible in the earlier stages of the design itself. So longer NPA timeline is a bigger challenge. And second thing, if the company is already running, product is okay, the capital and operational expenditure is a second challenge. Same product, same design, almost similar market share in the market. If one guy is selling at 1,000 rupees and he is incurring 500 rupees to make it, another guy is selling at 1,000 rupees and incurring 800 rupees to make it, company one is already profitable. They are prone to get more profit and develop more. So control of operational expenditure and capital investments for a factory to run. You should have optimum utilized resource, optimum inventory space, optimum floor space, and optimum tooling cost, everything. So in that area also, the manufacturing engineering plays a vital role. So in a typical industry, in automotive or off-highway, what we have seen till now is, while doing a pilot build from product design, when it goes into a pilot build, close to 200 DFM issues are almost being found out in the digital stage itself or in the manufacturing stage. So what happens is, if there is a DFM issue being found out, to rectify it, each issue might take rupees 1 lakh to solve, because it may call for a change in process, change in tool, or change in the design itself to some extent. So you need to go back to that timeline and again recheck everything, then bring back and ensure that that change in design does not affect any other part of the design in your product. So that takes time and that takes investment. That takes at least 20% of your timeline to launch the product. So if you are very good in your validation aspect of your design, your product will be quicker, 20% quicker to market than all others. And capital and operational also, there is a huge cost involved. A manufacturing engineer can help companies sustain in that area. These are the two areas where manufacturing engineer will have a bigger role in the company. Offerings. If an engineering service industry, if they say that we are doing manufacturing engineering services, then this is the sequence of the whole spectrum, what we used to say, the whole spectrum of services that a company used to provide if they are into manufacturing services, manufacturing engineering services. In when the product is getting finalized, you need to know DFM process plan, verify the bill of material, prepare work instruction, all that should be done. And once that process plan, everything is done, you need to plan for your jigs and fixtures and tooling. concept design, detailed design of your tooling, and support your supply in making the toolings. That should be another area. And digital manufacturing perspective, you, once that everything is your process and tool are ready, you need to validate your process using simulations. Throughput is the whole factory wide. Human simulation will talk about ergonomics. Robot simulation will talk about if there are multiple robots running in a factory, how they are performing. That all simulation can be done. And you, once the validation aspect is done, you need to think about layout, how well you are planning your layout in terms of whole factory and in terms of workspace of the operator, how the workspace of the operators is he having enough space to move around and make the product that he wants to make, and how is the line side layout, how is my material supply plan, what is my line side inventory, what is my warehouse inventory, am I going to keep a temporary buffer storage in between, how am I effectively utilizing the space, all that, this will come in layout design. Then when the factory starts running, you need to also check your whole value stream, how I am adding value to the product in each and every stage. And to add each value, how much am I investing? What is the cost for creating that value? And how many operators am I using? And what's the standard time they need to make the product? How much time should I give them to make the product? And if there are 20 to 30 operators in the line, are all the operators balanced enough? Am I underloading 15 of them and overloading 15 of them? Is the work evenly distributed or not? And lean manufacturing and world-class manufacturing has the philosophy that micro waste, what they say, the 8 different type of waste. Am I handling my wastes properly? Am I reducing my unnecessary waste in the facility and thereby improving the productivity of the plant? All these will come into picture. And once it is done, when you look into the warehouse, the receiving warehouse is there, shipping warehouse is there. And when you ship to other country, you are going to pack it and put it in a container and send it. So container effective utilization, space utilization of the container, what kind of trolleys or what kind of racks or any other crates that you are going to use to send your products, and what is the material handling equipment that you are going to use for handling the product, and yard, if you have a fleet of truck to distribute material and bring material into your plant, how many trucks you need, are they being effectively utilized, all these comes under logistics and warehouse. And support side, if a client is running a plant, we may also go in and support them in factory acceptance testing, installation, prove out trials, starting of production, pilot build, production with all these support will be given. So this is the overall spectrum of manufacturing engineering. And out of this whole ocean, today we are going to see this area only, digital manufacturing. That's our scope today for this discussion. We are handling only this. We can talk in each of these subjects and sub-subjects that we are mentioning here. We can talk for a day in each of these subjects. But today's idea is to talk on this specific digital manufacturing only. Digital spend trend. So when I talk about digital, now let us see how the digital area has improved over a time in the market. So from 2013, every 5 years they have plotted a curve. Zinnov, the rating agency, has done a market dipstick analysis and checked how much each industry is spending on their digital portion of R&D, ER&D. So it was about 1 trillion in 2013 and went to 2018, 1.2 trillion. And 2023, they are projecting about 1.7 trillion spend is the industry size. And out of that, 150 billion was there in 2013, and close to 300 billion is there in 2018, and 2023 they are expecting around 642 billion spend in the digital segment itself. Sorry, ER&D segment, digital segment, 642 billion, which is, if you see in 2013, it is around 15% only out of the whole pie, 15% of it was digital. In 2018, the pie is getting bigger and the spend is also getting bigger in terms of percentage. And 2023, again, pie gets bigger and even spend gets bigger. So overall, if you see only the digital volume, that is 4 times growth in the last 10 years time. From 2013 to 23, the industry has become 4 times bigger. That much volume is there to play in digital, and it is going to further move up only. It is not going to go in the lower trend because of all these the recent simulation of sensors and internet for IoT industry 4.0, we are going to spend more only, not less. So the volume is high. So which means what I'm trying to say is there is a lot of focus to be given in this area. We need to look what is happening here. And industry focus. Okay, industry digital is growing, and I'm saying that you need to concentrate where all the opportunities are for industry to invest and industry is to function, and where all we can concentrate is across the industry where you have automotive, off-highway, industrial products, medical, or internet and software, telecom, high-tech. In all the industries, the plant, there is an existing plant, we need to renew and modernize it to make it capable of taking the digital technology inside and run it. That is one portion. So which means you need to go back and see all your machines. You need to bring a lot of robotics inside, sensors inside, connect the sensors to next sensor, and make it function unanimously in a plant, that one's output is other's input, make them talk to each other. That kind of factory 4.0 things are going to be needed. So that will also happen very much predominantly in the industry in India right now and in the near future. And when you set up a new factory, build a new product, we also have to concentrate on connecting each other already. The device or anything that we are developing or anything we are making should already have an inbuilt option to talk to its prior and the next devices or prior and next machines or stations. So connectivity should be already inbuilt into the products that we are going to make it. Smart, that's what they say, smart everything. Whatever you are building, it should have a smart. Smart means nothing but there should be a sensor that is taking the data and it should give out so that it is being given to a server that has a analytics data, and it analyzes and gives the feedback back into
the machine. In the field of data science, what are the job roles you people have? There are three job roles. One is data engineer. I'm just starting from the right hand side. Mm-hmm. Then data analyst, then data scientist. Data preparation phase.
What happened?
The person as a data engineer has to understand.
I am hearing other video also.
Data engineer collect the data from various sources.
I think, are we interrupting with the other class that is going on? Maybe, probably, there is an interaction. I'm hearing other classes.
Okay.
I can continue, huh?
Yeah, please.
Okay, right, sure. Right, okay. So what I was talking is, your factory, existing factory also should be improved, and your new factory that we are going to plan also should have the smartness inbuilt. That is the scope area for the digital engineering in focus right now. And out of this, again, the next few slides that we are going to mainly see are going to be in this only, digital tools what we are using, factory 4.0. This is the area. There is a whole ocean available, and out of this, we are again going to see this small portion in the next few slides. So what kind of offerings that an engineering service company right now are providing to a global customer base across the world, the companies that are doing? Next few slides that we see are going to be the typical offerings in digital simulation segment only. That one small box that we saw, that's the offering that I'm going to describe now. So step one is animator work instruction. This is on the process planning perspective. So you have planned your process, you know how you have to make it. You need to explain the operator on how to make it. In every station, there is going to be a work instruction. So if any industrial engineer is there in the line, or they know work instruction is the basic thing that we prepare for each workstation. Each operator should know what he should make, and for that, he'll be given an Excel format or PDF or Word format, work instruction in hand, which will typically look like this on the left side of the screen, with the pictures or drawings or anything on, with the arrow marks on what he should do. So he will read through that. He'll be given training on that particular operation for a day or two, and he will be assigned into the shop floor in the direct live production build. So using his acquired knowledge in the training on the few days or hours, he will start to build the product in the line. If there is any question, he will look back into the work instruction and see what it is. And the work instruction also serves as a tool to anybody new coming into the line, any visitor or any other person who comes into the line, he will quickly go through the work instruction to see what is happening in that line. It's a mandatory requirement of any lean or any company will have it definitely as a part of process itself. So now what happens is this work instruction is moved to a digital work instruction. We ourselves have implemented this in many of the assembly lines in the USA. And right now in India also, for a few of the home appliances manufacturers, we are doing this. In US, we started to give a 50-inch big digital screen and we gave it. But in India, they use a small tab, 10-12-inch tab in each workstation. And each workstation will have this automatic running digital work instruction that the operator can quickly see and understand what he has to do. I'll quickly run through this to see how it looks. So this is how a digital work instruction will be in the shop floor. You input the CAD model from the PLM. Then you animate each and every operation sequence and you give the part number. You can see what part number is coming inside. And any specific instruction for the operator can be given in the instruction area. How much quantity should be brought in, at what time he has to build this, all that can be given in the work instruction. So this, what happens is, apart from being a standard document that satisfies a lean manufacturing requirement or any standard requirement, this also serves as a training manual kind of thing for any new operator. So any new operator now who comes into the line need not always rely on a senior operator or a line leader to come and support him when there is a question, because whatever he wants to do is running in front of him directly in animation. He can see it and see the sequence, what kind of tool he needs to get. This can be further added with the tools that he needs to use. All comments can be brought in the window area itself. So what happens is this becomes easy, ready reference for any operator to quickly see and understand how he needs to build this product. So that becomes the biggest advantage, and a manufacturing engineer who knows the process on how to do it only can make this kind of animation for the operator, animation work instructions. So this falls under manufacturing engineer's role. So he knows what to do and he can animate it and give instruction to the operator on what to do. This will be displayed in a wherever, if there is a budget constraint, the customers generally want us to do this for a critical stations. Or if it is a very quick, they want to, if they perceive value may very much important, they have asked us to do in all station also. So in appliances manufactured in India, we are doing this for in each every assembly station. We are putting up animated work instruction like this for any, because they have frequently changing operators who are from North India. It's very tough to keep on educating them. So you run this, they can see the animated work instruction and understand what is happening and do the same in the line. So this is one, animated work instruction is one area where digital tools are being extensively used right now. Second step is human simulation, right? You designed the process. Now you need to validate if a human being is going to work on that particular workstation. So what we need to next validate is, okay, if a person is going to work 8 hours a day and 20 days per month or approximately 200 to 40 days per year, if he's going to work on the same station continuously, is he prone to get any injury because of the postures or positions that we are giving him to make this particular product? Mm-hmm. So the tool that he is handling or the position we are making him to work, if it is going to create any problem to him. So there are two kinds of analysis. One is called a RULA and another is called a REBA. RULA is rapid upper limb analysis, in which you analyze your shoulders, upper body, the complete shoulder and forearm, this wrist and all this area. In this, because this is your maximum area that we'll be using while doing assembly or while doing a function, your upper part of the body and shoulder and hand, this is where you are prone to get maximum load. So this analysis is very, very critical. And REBA is rapid entire body analysis. That is your whole body, what kind of posture you are being in, Are you bending in awkward 20-30 degree posture to continuously do a product? Or will it give you a back pain maybe along a month? If you work for a month, is it going to give any issue? And also visibility analysis. In this position, in this posture, if you look at the product that you want to assemble, are you able to see it properly? Will the operator will be able to see, and will he be able to assemble it properly? Or this particular station is not even the right station. We have to do this operation one step before or one step after. All this decision will be made by using this tool. I'll run a quick simple, quick video for you to understand. This is on a vehicle assembly line. This operator is going to assemble a seat, I think. He needs to tighten the bolt under the seat. He'll be given a tool and he needs to bend, look under, and tighten the bolt. That's what his operation is in this station. So this tool, by using Delmia, this is Delmia, I think. Delmia V5. Similar tools are available. Tool is not a matter. Right now, we have a lot of Technomatics jack is another thing available. Similarly, a lot of other validation tools are available in the market. Each tool has similar capability. You have to finalize the mannequin depending on which country the product is going to be assembled. You need to understand the average height of the worker, male or female, what worker will be working, what is the average height and average weight of them, so that you build the mannequin first, bring the mannequin inside and make them stand in the station and make them perform the operation. You see, you can see the red color highlighting wherever he is bending an awkward posture or wherever there is a awkward wrist movement. These are all the scores that we'll get. The higher the score, it is worst. The lower the score, the better it is. We need to ensure there are no red or orange color highlighted in any of the operations. So what will happen is, if there is a red or orange, we need to tweak your process. You need to give a different tool. Rather than a mechanical tool, you change the tool. You give him any pneumatic or hydraulic, any other operator tool, and make him to work on it. Or you adjust the height and see if the fixture height can, if changing a height of fixture can help him. If none of that is working, you need to go back to the design and check, will we be able to do it in one station before? Or is it okay to do it one station after? If that also does not work, you need to go back to your design department and say that this is not working. You need to think about something different, or put the bolt somewhere else, or give me some other position so that my operator will not be having an issue. So this is one. And the small window that you are seeing is the visibility analysis. The same tool will also validate if the operator will be able to see what he is doing, because you need to see the bolt properly so that you can place the tool on top of the bolt. So that's another important thing. So visibility check also will be done using the same tool. Whether he'll be able to properly see it and whether he'll be able to properly build it. If there is any other additional tool or any other additional support needed, will be the analysis outcome of this particular issue. So using this tool, if you validate a bit before it goes to the shop floor, we have seen approximately 50 to 60% reduction in issues. When generally if 100 issues pops up, this tool will eliminate about 50 issues. After this tool also, there will be some other unexpected, because of the situation in the shop floor or because of change in some tool or change in some scenario, you will encounter some issues, but drastic drop in the issues can be found out by using this kind of digital human validation. Next thing, same ergonomic validation in 2020. What I have shown is, this is 2010, 2015, when I was effectively running around doing analysis and optimization. This was the tool. Right now, since the advent invasion of sensors into the market, we have much better solution doing the same thing using a different method. I'll run this so that you will see. Now what happens is, sensors are given. I have taken it from online, this one, because I cannot show many of the things that we are doing in the company. Now what happens is, the operator is given sensors in all the shoulder, forearm, wherever she'll be getting stress, including neck and other area, she'll be installed with the sensor and she'll be asked to do the same work in the floor itself. When she is doing, parallelly the software will evaluate and tell us that what are the areas that she is getting high stress. So the advantage of over the previous method is the analysis on this method is very quick. The one that I showed you in the previous slide, that will approximately take an engineer to about 40 to 50 hours to validate that whole process, that whole station. Whereas this one can be probably done in a whole day. You need to go to the factory, that's the only thing, and install the sensor on the operator. Once it is installed, you need to make them work and parallelly see. If you see whatever she is working, the software is also doing and analyzing side by side, upper arm, what it is, forearm, degree, what is it, and what is the score of what the operation she is doing. That can be parallelly checked. So this is an improvement to the previous. So digital technology is also evolving step by step. So from the, and at this juncture, there are industries who are using that also and who are using this also. Because for this, you need to be present.
That can be parallelly checked. So this is an improvement to the digital technology.
Correct. Advancement in the digital technology. So in the digital itself, this is the next step actually. So what advantage is quicker timeline. Disadvantage may be you need to be physically present there. There should be operation workstation available when the operator is working. You need to be there and tell them to work on that particular operation directly and take it. Whereas the previous tool will do a lot of things digitally, virtually. The product need not be there. You can just send a 3D model from anywhere across the globe to a company in India or any other global location. You download it and you create the virtual environment. You make them work on the tool digitally and take the output, but it takes four times more time. So now if the country is ready to spend, we can send an engineer from here and with the sensors, he can directly go to the shop floor and put it on the operator and assemble it, make them work and take the output directly and submit the report. And this, what will happen, the output of the analysis is same. Again, you are going to change the process or change the tool or change the design itself. That's how it is going to work. So this is on ergonomic validation, where a human being is there. When a person is assembling something or when a person is working on a factory, you will do this analysis. Next step. Okay, now along with the human beings, I have a robot also. So what will happen? Many of the car automotive companies, mostly car or any off-highway vehicles also, nowadays you see a lot of robots in welding stations, some in assembly stations. Most robo weld happen, spot welding and other welding stations, lot of robo, and that's a whole line, huge line completely. The whole inner body itself, the body in white is being spot welded. Over 3 lakh welding spots or something is there in a single car. So which means you need to have multiple stations and multiple robots operating in each station. So when there are multiple robots, the team outside the country itself can simulate the robo here and take an offline programming outside and give the programming codes to the team in the country that is implementing. For example, Europe or US or anywhere, you do it from India, you take the code out, you send the code, the engineer there will put the code inside the robo, do a trial run and then start working on the robots. Where it is very much helpful, when there are 2 or 3 robots running in tandem in a line, are they going to clash with each other when they are welding? Or if they are going to clash it with each other, how are we planning the stages for the robot that they don't interfere with each other, but they complete the whole car body in a stipulated amount of time? How are we going to ensure it? So that analysis, this is one area that I have seen engineers working 10-15 years in the same. This looks to be one slide for us, but this is the whole life of some of the engineers that I have seen in my career. His core competency is in robo programming and robo clash analysis. And for 10-15 years, he has been doing this. Maybe the tools will be different. The software that he uses is different, but this is one area where people spend the whole lifetime. I'll show you the video. I think one of the factories, Volvo or some factory video was there. Volvo car, how they simulated using a software and how it is running in the plant. This video was, it's the same thing that we do in the companies also using a software. This is the floor, this is the assembly station where the side wall is coming and getting merged with the body, where the robots are going to tack weld the side body. Body construction and top, I think roof is also coming. This is the software that we use. Again, Delmia and other softwares are there. Each software has the capability. Software is not a matter here. You give what kind of robot it is, what make, what model here, and you design the grippers and the fixtures for the robot, how the robot's gripper should be, what is the angle of gripper, what is the length and size of the gripper. And there are four robots working in the same station. So each robot will have their specific area. They will not clash with each other, and they'll be, see the roof is coming now, I think. This is validated digitally before, and the same, whatever digital validation happened, the same program has been, offline programming was done. The same program has been sent to the shop floor there, and they install it in the robot. See, each robot should not clash with each other. So at a given point of time, if one robot is working in one area, the other robot will not come to that place. It will do some other work or it will be idle. They will share the workspace in such a way that they don't clash with each other. And this has to be ensured from an engineer sitting over here in India. So this is your robot programming, clash analysis, and between human also might come. So if a human being is there inside the cell, between them and the robot, what should be the sequence? Between the robot, what should be the sequence? And even the fixture, gripper, all the design will also be under our control. We will suggest to them, instead of going for this fixture, let us, this kind of rotating fixture is needed. All that can be suggested by engineer here, designed by us, and the drawings are sent to the customer there. They make it in their tool room. Sometimes they ask us to make the fixture in India and ship it to them. So both happens. So if they have a tool room, you send the drawing, they will make it. If they don't have a tool room support, they ask us to give a turnkey solution. So we make the fixture and we send it to them. So this is on robo analysis. Then comes the, okay, till now, till this point, whatever we were seeing is on a one station, and in that station, in that process, what is happening? Whoever is working on that work cell, what is happening? This is plant simulation is something we talk about on a whole plant level. You bird's eye view, look at the plant from the input to the output, how each part is moving inside, how each parts are coming and getting assembled, how much time it is sitting in one station, what is the next station, how much time it spends there, who is working there, what is the efficiency of that operator, what is the efficiency of that workstation. So this is on a lean perspective, many of the companies are doing this kind of simulation study in which you analyze the whole factory, analyze your whole resources you are investing in. Your space is a resource. How much space are you using to build a product is a resource. You are paying rent for the space or you are spending for the space. In a 100 feet by 100 feet space, if you are able to accommodate two production line, your profitability increases. So space is a resource. The number of people you invest is a resource. The work in progress components is a resource that you are putting. You are putting money on each and every resource being utilized in the plant is getting evaluated by this plant simulation. I'll quickly run through that also. This is on a, I think, Siemens Technomatics. Similarly, there are many other software called FlexSim and I think Visual Components. A lot of other similar softwares are there. So here, I think they have given one assembly line, one evaluation of one assembly line where you get input product, it goes through a conveyor, it goes to main assembly station one, then again goes to a conveyor, goes to assembly station two and three, and then comes here. There are some other assembly station and some testing station is there. A portion of it will go to test, a portion of it will come to this place, and then it will come out of the line, it goes to the finished part and then to the warehouse. So you build your model as such, it is in the production line. So this can also happen in two ways. When you don't even have the plant, you can virtually get to the layout that you have planned, build this plant on top of, build this model on top of the layout itself, give all the dimensions as per the layout. Between the station one and station two, if there are 2 meters gap, you can give this conveyor length as 2 meter. Then another 2 meter, you can give the dimension. So you can build exactly as such you are planning in future, and run this and evaluate and see that if this much space is enough for me to make this product. Or if you have already existing factory, you can build that also in here and check what is my utilization. So advantage of being doing this for a greenfield plant is before even you start to build, before even you go to the civil part, you will know my plant will run in the efficiency of 80% or 85%. That you'll be able to. So this is a model he has built. I think I'll show it running here somewhere. These are the parameters that we used to give in the machine. What is the setup time? What is the cycle time? If there is a failure, you will have past history of the machines, right? So how much time, once in how much time does it fail? And if it fails once, what is my mean time to repair? MTBF, MTTR and MTBF data, they say. You input that also inside. So which means the factory will run in the software as if it is running in the real condition. There is a lot of probability theory inside it, a lot of basics of the probability you need to know to design this kind of simulation. But eventually, this will give you an idea about how a real plant, if a real plant is built in this way, how this will work. So he has built, his shift calendar is there. Shift calendar will give you what shift are you operating and how many workers are you using. So this is now running as if the factory is running real time. Only thing is you can quickly run and see for 1 year what is the utilization, for 1 month what is the utilization, you can see. You may be able to see the regular, the part is going in this way, and once in 10 pieces or something, it will go through the testing. He has run it for 1 day and he has seen the output. Now, advantage of this machine, this software is you can open the graph side by side. This is the shift calendar. He has given how much time the operators is working, what is the break time, all these can be given inside. So here he is bringing the, this is for our understanding. In the real time, when the shop floor is running, you can see which operator or which station is getting utilized to what extent. So this will give anybody an idea whether this line has potential to add any other products inside, or is there any one machine that is blocking other machines from performing to the fullest. If I add any one critical machine additionally into this line, will my line's efficiency go double? We have seen in many cases, in many of the assembly lines, one specific machine will be blocking all other 10 machines inside. If you improve the capability of that one machine, or if you add that additional machine to another one machine nearby, the whole line's capacity goes 30%, 40% more. That kind of evaluation is possible by using this kind of software. So this will ensure that you are making your product on an optimum cost. You are utilizing your resources fully, your space, your factory, number of workers, your number of machines, tools, whatever you say, you are utilizing it properly. So that's the purpose of this tool. I think that's for plant simulation. So these, whatever we have seen, these 4-5 slides, these are the main digital validation aspects that any company is doing at this juncture. So there are some sensors coming in. So maybe in few years time, this simulation tool also may become obsolete. There'll be some other tools coming in, but the digital validation is happening right now in the factories, in the industry across the globe, they are doing. And what are the advantages? By doing it in the last 15 years, 10 years, lifetime in the multiple across the industries, what we have seen is product development time has come by 20%. We can vouch in any factory if you go, if you concentrate on simulating and validating before it comes to the shop floor, you will be able to reduce your product development time by 20%. Reduction in DFM issues by 60-65%, it happens. Inventory reduction at least 50% we can do. Utilization of resources, your man, machine, your space, everything at least by 50%. Space utilization, at least the space can be reduced by 10%. That is, you can create extra space for other extra tasks, or you can reduce your factory size and pay less rent in comparison. These are all the benefits to the customer. So that is on digital. This is future, the new world that we are going. Wherever you go, you'll be always hearing the name smart factory, smart this, smart that, industry 4.0. All the names pops up here and there whenever you discuss with anybody. So imagine a factory that has operators and machines inside, and each machine and operator has sensor data available, and whatever they are doing is getting captured because sensors are now low cost. Previously it was costly. PLCs and PCBs were used to do automation. Nowadays, instead of that PLC and PCB, lot of new smaller sensors have come into the picture. In 50 rupees, 100 rupees, you are able to put a sensor and get a data out of it. So imagine a factory which is connected end to end. The operators are connected. Connected means connected to a server. So whatever these guys are doing are getting captured, and in real time it is being moved to a server there. And what happens is, you have all the digital simulation tools that you see, right? The plant simulation or any other analysis and validation tool, the server has it. And whatever input till now we were giving is from an Excel format. If the client customer gives us, this is taking this many minutes, or I have this shift time, this break time, all these are from our past history, we understand and input as a hard code numbers. But imagine if that can happen real time. If your operator takes a break, the machine counts that as a break, the simulation counts that as a break. So what happens is the real-time data is get fed into the simulation software or into the server. The server does the analytics, and from the analytics, the server gives the next plan, that is to achieve 1 month production from day 1 to day 10. I have crossed this much, and at this 10th day, I'm in this position. So 11th day, what should be my production plan? 12th day, what will be my production plan, depending on 11th day output? This all can be effectively concurrently managed. So all these areas, production flow, real time, this line triggering for forklift to take the material which is ready, or you're implementing condition-based maintenance and monitoring. If a vibration in a machine is going a little bit off, so previously we know 6 months before when this kind of vibration occurred, the machine was down. So when slowly that vibration occurs itself, the system will tell you your machine is going to fail. At the end of the day, go and replace this motor. So in which is possible, because out of your office time, you'll be able to make the machine ready. And the next day when the product operator comes inside, your line is up and running. You reduce your loss time. So this is the future. We are not going to talk much on this aspect. Till now, what I wanted to give you is the digital aspect of what is possible to do. And in future, the smart factories will combine with the digital technologies what is available. And with the digital technology and with your IT engineers' analytics capability, the plant itself will be capable of taking real-time decisions to proceed further and to meet the expectation of the customer. That's a smart factory. I think that is what I wanted to talk to you today. We are done with the presentation, and if there are any questions, we can take it up and discuss further.
Sir?
Yeah.
Understood. One participant, Mr. Manikandan. Yes, Sivakadacham has asked two questions, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any service offered for border operations? Is there any sensor available to give alarm to indicate the damages in the border to avoid explosions?
Yeah, where is there? Boiler operation side. For example, you can have a temperature sensor, you can say vibration sensor, depending on what parameter you generally monitor in a boiler, there are sensors available. Nowadays, there is sensor to measure pretty much everything. Human body itself, they are installing a sensor and measuring the muscle contraction and relaxation. So imagine the kind of sensor that is available in the market right now. So if you have a specific need on measuring any temperature or pressure or vibration, there are sensors available. You can monitor, and depending on the range the sensor is, we can take decisions also. If the sensor gives any, for example, water tank also they are doing, the sensor, water level indicator sensor is there. When the water touches, it pops up an alarm. That can also be given. That's possible, highly possible. Yeah.
So they are asking, is there any service offered for boiler operations, like consultation like that?
Will be definitely. I will check it up and get back. There are people available there, which means what happens here is you need to have two teams working together. One is your automation and sensor team, and one is your boiler expert. They both have to sit and discuss, and the boiler expert need to tell what they want to measure, what they want to control, and this automation team will support them in creating that solution. By merging the two teams together, this issue can be solved. Yeah, it is possible.
Yes, yes. One more question. Can robots can be used to identify the damage in inner core of the boiler? Is there any consulting agency to do such work?
Okay, to send the robot inside and check, and it should be definitely possible. I need to verify if there is anybody consulting on that area, because you need to send a smaller robot inside only with the vision system. It needs to just see inside, and if there is any crack or anything, it needs to tell us there is a crack. Okay. I'll check it out. If there is anybody doing it, I can get back to you on that.
Next, one question from Professor Devanathan Ramachandran. Is there any open source software for plant simulation or other similar to Dalmia?
Open source, as of now, I have not seen any. Maybe we can check that also, because there are some low cost, some high cost people running here and there. In my last 5 years, I have seen whatever software I have seen is all paid software only. There was no open source available. But only thing in open source is whatever these people are giving in Dalmia, the amount of the robots data that are inside, the machines data that are inside, which will not be the open source. You may have to extensively do a research and bring all the data inside in open source. That may be taking some time to utilize the open source to do this kind of operation. To my understanding, till now it is not there. I can give a quick check also if there is anything.
One more question from the participant, Mr. Manikandan is Sivakadattam. Recent explosion in NNRC indicate what type of failure?
It can be anything, because boiler's pressure has gone up. So maybe pressure sensor did not work.
Yes.
Or their sensing system, that whatever alarm it has to give, it did not give. Or suddenly it happened means, is there any other failure that will lead to pressure increase? We need to see the allied systems also. If some other input system failed because of that, the pressure suddenly increased. And before even the alarm comes, it suddenly blasted. It can happen.
One more question from Dinesh Kumar Saravanan. This implementation of automatic measures does make the decrease in job opportunities.
Automatic mission, yeah. To some extent, yes. To some extent, no. Because there are, if there is automation coming into one area, to do that, there are a lot of manual labor needed, not to design, to plan the automation, to write the code. So where we go for automation, wherever there is an issue with deploying a human being, where we feel that it is not, that area is contagious, if we deploy a human, there may be issue for him, we go for automation. Or if you want consistent result or something, we go for automation. So if there is a robot being deployed, there is a company that is building robo.
Yes, sir.
So robo companies are not being built by robo itself, right? There are people. Yeah. So that creates opportunity only.
Yes, sir.
I have not seen the reducing. Yeah.
Yes, sir. One participant, Dr. M. Shanmugapuriyan. If any MNC industry has implemented FMS and the AGV related system, what is the current scenario related to this?
AGV and FMS, nowadays everyone is a lot of in India, we need to see if they have effectively started using AGV. But AGV itself, there are a lot of varieties. Now you have a path drawn in magnetic line, and the AGV follows magnet, that is one available. And there are sensors given and coordinates given. The AGV gives tracks the path and goes to a location. AGVs are there. It is costly in Amazon kind of industries. We are seeing it right now at this juncture. In factories like Nissan, also recently I've seen AGV being used to the cart is there, an assembly line. It picks up the product, it picks up the kit, and the kit moves and goes to the assembly line and delivers to the assembly line. The whatever kit is being brought in is lifted and assembled into the assembly line, and the AGV comes back and takes the next product kit and goes back. In all the OEMs, preferably you go to any OEM like Ford or Nissan or Toyota, you can see that kind of AGV is definitely giving parts.
Okay, sir. That's all the question from the participant. If you want to give any information to the participant, sir.
My email is there in the presentation itself. Maybe if there is any query, they can contact me so that I'll be happy to discuss with anybody from any industry that they are facing any challenges. We can find out right people to solve the issue, because the main idea that we started giving this kind of webinars is to make the people aware of the technologies that are available in the market that global companies are using, which India is not right now predominantly using. We want the people to be aware there are solutions like this available in the market and there are people doing it, so that we can connect them to the right people and improve the industry as much as possible.
Yes, sir.
So be in touch. I have my email, given my email.
Okay,
you can send questions to my email. I can find out any answers for you also.
One more request, sir. So many participants are asking your PPT. Shall we send the PPT of
The PDF version I send now, it's only 2 MB or 3 MB, I think.
Okay, sir.
Or the 80 MB file also you can, or you can send the YouTube links I have given with this PPT. This 2 MB.
Okay, sir. With the permission, I will give them. Okay.
Okay, sir.
I will give the vote of thanks, sir. Then I will let us conclude the webinar. Okay, sir.
Sure.
On behalf of EGS Pillai Engineering College and the Department of Mechanical Engineering, I take this opportunity to thank Mr. Sundar Narayanan, sir, Lead Consultant, Teams Private Limited, Chennai, for his excellent presentation on the topic of Manufacturing Engineering as a Service Offering. I am very much proud that Mr. Sundar Narayanan is an alumni of EGS Pillai Engineering College, Nagapattinam. Really, it is very much useful to all the participants and industry experts. Next, I would like to thank all the participants from various institutions and industries. I thank our chairman and our secretary, Dr. S. Parameswaran, for their excellent support for this webinars. I would like to thank our CEO, Dr. Chandrasekharan, sir, for his excellent efforts taken by him to conduct this type of webinars. I thank our principal, Dr. S. Ramabalan, for his support. And I thank all HODs and faculties of EGS Pillai Engineering College and a group of institutions. Once again, I thank Mr. Sundar Narayanan, sir, for his excellent webinar presentation. All the participants will get e-certificate registration link after 1 hour of end of this webinar. So kindly fill up the feedback link, then you will get the certificate will be generated automatically. With this, let us conclude the webinar. Thank you very much to all. Thank you, Sundar Narayanan, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you.
Close the webinar.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah.